सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। नमः श्री शंकरानंद नमः श्री शंकरानंद गुरुपादाम्बुजन्मने गुरुपादाम्बुजन्मने सविलास महामोह सविलास महामोह ग्राहग्रासैककर्मणे ग्राहग्रासैककर्मणे। Now the discussion is where the author shows how Satchit Ananda Asti Bhadi Priyam is that which inheres in every name and form. It was said in the verse 70, Mrudvatte Satchidanandaha Anugachandi Sarvada. Just as in various pots and other things that are made out of clay, how the clay inheres in every product of clay, in every modification of clay. Nirakashe sadadinam anubhutihi. And similarly also in all the elements, like space, air, fire, water, in everything, and then the products of the elements, everywhere we find also an inheritance of Satchit Ananda Asti Bhati Priyam. Because the space is. So, example was taken of space, or is akasha, because that is the first element that is said to be created. So, first thing that becomes manifest is akasha. So, that is taken here as an illustration. Adyo vikara akasha. The first modification is akasha of the space. Sahasti bhatyabhi chapriya. It is there, akasha exists. Akasha shines and Akasha is agreeable. And it has this being there, shining and being agreeable is something that is inherent in Akasha in everyone. Because these are the qualities of the cause. The thing is, whenever an effect is produced from the cause, then effect always carries the qualities of the cause, plus sometimes its own peculiar effects also, for its own peculiar qualities also. For example, clay is the cause. And the pot is the effect. So pot being the effect of the product will carry or inhere all the qualities of the clay. Plus it will have its own peculiar qualities also. For example, the pot has a form. It has a name. So that is something unique to the pot, unique to the effect. Whereas the substance of the pot is clay, and that is something that the pot has inherited from the cause. So the effect of the product inheres the qualities of the cause, plus also possesses some of its own qualities. Similarly also, Brahman is Brahman, which is Satchit Ananda, or Asti Bhadi Priyam, is the fundamental cause. And we say that Akasha, or the space, is the first effect or product from Brahman. In which case, the effect must necessarily reflect the qualities or characteristics of the cause, plus it should reflect its own qualities also. And therefore, the first effect called Akasha, the space, reflects the qualities or characteristics of Brahma, which is Satchit Ananda. Asti Bhati Priyam. Akasha, the space, is. It shines and it is agreeable. And then it also has its own peculiar quality. And what is it? To accommodate. So, Avakasha Stasya Rupam. And to be able to accommodate, so accommodativeness is the peculiar quality that Akasha, the space, has, that is of its own. Of these, what is real and what is unreal? We say that the qualities, the characteristics of the cause, Asti, Bhadi, Priyam, they are real. And this peculiar quality that space has to accommodate is mithya or unreal or is projected. Similarly, in a pot, what is real and what is unreal? The qualities or characteristics of the cause, namely clay, that is real in the pot, whereas the form that the pot has and the name and other things, they are unreal, projected. Now the question was that, okay, you can say that as long as Akasha is, that there is Asti, Bhati, Priyam, and the peculiar quality of Akasha, namely the accommodation. But then, suppose this Akasha, the space, also is dismissed from your mind. Then, where does this Asti, Bhati, Priyam go? See, real or the truth is that which can never be dismissed. And Mithya is that which is subject to being dismissed. So if you say that, in this example of space, if Asti, Bhati and Priyam is a real, and the spaceness or accommodation is unreal, then when we dismiss that space also from our thought, meaning that my mind becomes totally devoid of any thought at all, not even the thought of space, at that time, is it not that Asti, Bhati, Priyam or Satchit Ananda also is dismissed? The answer is no. That even when there is no thought of space or no thought at all, even then one thing shines, and that is the self, which illumines even the absence of the thought, and that self itself is Asti, Bhati and Priyam. And that being the case, said verse 72, Tadruktvadeva tatsattvam audasinyena tatsukham. Therefore we say that anything is akasha is also of the nature of ananda or happiness. Because even when the space is not, something remains, and that something is the reality of the space, and that is the Asti, Bhati and the Priyam. So inasmuch as space, even the absence of space, also is illumined by the self, though we say that space also is the nature of sukha or happiness. Because in the space there is no anukulya and pratikulyam. What is the nature of happiness? So happiness of the self is that which is devoid of the ideas of anukulya and pratikulya, devoid of the ideas of agreeability and disagreeability, or desirability or undesirability. Because wherever there is this notion of desirability, we must know that the projection of the mind is involved. Or wherever there is undesirability, we also know that the projection of mind is involved. So desirability and undesirability are states of mind. When the mind also is not there, there is no desirability, no undesirability, then what is there? What is there is what we call ananda or sukham or happiness, which is natural to the self. This was explained in verse 73. Anukulye harshadhi syat pratikulye tu dukkhadhi dvayabhave nijanandah nija dukkham natukvachita. Anukulye harshadhi syat. When there is an object, or there is anything, a situation, a person, an object, or whatever, when it is judged by me as agreeable or desirable or attractive, harshadhi syat, there is what we call a reaction in the form of harsha or elation. Pratikulye tu dukkhadihi. Whereas when something is judged as pratikula, as disagreeable or undesirable, then dukkhadihi, there is a reaction in the form of an aversion, or the form of sadness or sorrow. So both these are reactions, harsha and shoka. Elation and sadness, both of these are reactions to the mind. Dvayabhave nijanandaha. Generally we can say that the reaction of elation is due to rajas, and the reaction in the form of grief or sadness is due to tamas. Dvayabhave, when both these kinds of reactions are absent, neither there is elation, nor is there rejection, or sadness, or sorrow. Meaning the rajas also is not there, tamas also is not there. Dvayabhave nijanandaha. What remains is nijanandaha, meaning the ananda, that is the self. And therefore, the self is of the nature of ananda, Brahma is of the nature of ananda. Then just a question was asked, why can't you say that if happiness is the nature of the self, why can't you even say that unhappiness could also be the nature of self? Then we say that dukkhe nija rupa siddhi abhavat mayavam. It says no, dukkha or unhappiness or sadness can never be the state of the, can never be the nature of the self. Because we said the other day that there is a natural love for the self, and there is natural love for happiness. There never is a love for unhappiness. That shows that unhappiness cannot be the nature of the self, happiness alone can be the nature of self. Now we continue our discussion with verse 74. There is a question, Nanu, Nijanandasya Sadanandatvat Sarvada Harsheva Syat. You are saying that the self is of the nature of ananda or happiness. If self is of the nature of happiness, then should it not be that constantly I should experience happiness? That my mind should always be happy or related, should it not be? Sarvada harshaheva syat. Harsham is elation. So would I not have this elation all the time because you say that the atma or the self is of the nature of happiness? Natu shokaha. And there can never be grief. If atma is the nature of happiness, why is there ever grief? How come all the time I don't feel great or all the time I don't experience that harsha or the elation? Then the answer to this question is, tasya nityatvevi tad grahinah manasah kshanikatvena manasayoho api kshanikatvam. The idea is that true, atma is always of the nature of ananda. But in order for me to know that atma is ananda or happiness, it is necessary to have a mind that reflects that happiness. Inasmuch as mind is something momentary, now it is happy, then it is unhappy, therefore we say that all this happiness and unhappiness must all necessarily be the states of mind. So his question was, why can't you say that unhappiness also is the nature of the self? But there also I experience happiness, and therefore you say that the happiness is the nature of the self. Then unhappiness also I equally experience even more. Why can you not say that unhappiness is the nature of the self? The answer is that experience, happiness and unhappiness, both are that which displaces, each one displacing the other, is nothing but a state of mind that is not the nature of the self. And that is what is said in the verse 74. Nijanande sthire harsha, nijanande sthire harsha, shokayor vyatyayah kshanad, shokayor vyatyayah kshanad, manasah kshanikatvena, manasah kshanikatvena, tayor manasateshyadam, tayor manasateshyadam. Nijanande sthire harsha shokayoho vyatyayah kshanat. So nijanande sthire. Nijananda means the ananda of nija, meaning of the self. Sthire, even though the self which of the ananda which is the nature of the self is sthira, meaning is always abiding. The ananda which is the nature of the self is always abiding, always obtaining. Harsha shokayoho vyatyayah kshanat. Whereas this harsha meaning the elation and shoka meaning depression, both of these vyatyayah, both of these replace each other, or both have come after one another. Now there is harsha and then there is shoka. This is called vyatyayah. Vyatyayah means passing over. So harsha comes and is passed over by shoka. That comes and again harsha. Kshanat, in a moment the mind changes from the state of elation to the state of depression. Manasah kshanikatvena, because the mind is momentary. Tayoho manasada ishyadam. Therefore you have to say that both harsha and shoka are the states of the mind. They are not the states of the self. So the question is, how come you are not all the time experiencing harsha or elation when happiness is the nature of the self? We say that the harsha or the elation is the state of mind, not the nature of the self. Self is ananda, which is that which obtains when the superimposition of harsha and the shoka, both of them are gone. So both harsha and the shoka amount to projection or superimposition. And when none of this is there, then what obtains is really nothing but the ananda, that is the self. That is when the mind becomes clear. When the mind becomes devoid of both these reactions arising from rajas and tamas, then mind becomes sattvic or tranquil or transparent. And what obtains in that mind is what we call cheerfulness, ananda. Svatmaramam muditavadanam. Acharyendram karakalidachin mudram ananda rupam. So that which is ananda rupam, the nature of ananda, Dakshinamurti. Svatmaramam, reveling is the reveling. In Svatmarama, reveling in his own self. Mudita Vadanam, and that ananda which is there as the nature of the self, becomes manifest as a gentle smile on the face. So the gentle smile that is on the face of Dakshinamurti or on any other devata reveals the very ananda which is the nature of the self. That laughter would be an expression of rajas. That laughing is nothing but a reaction. It is an expression of rajas. And depression, of course, is also a reaction, which is a product of tamas. But what we call a gentle smile, that's the reason why we find a gentle smile on the lips of all the devatas. Not a stern face, not a laughing face either, but a gentle smile. That shows the inner purity and the inner joy. And so that's what is shown there. And therefore we say Harsha and Ashoka, both of them are the states of the mind. And they are momentary. Because now there is Harsha, then there is Shoka. But then Nijananda is Thire. Whereas Nijananda or the Ananda of the Self is Thire, is that which always obtains. It just gets stifled or gets veiled because of this reacting mind. When the mind stops reacting, stops projecting, then becomes abiding, and then the Nijananda or the Ananda that is of the Self becomes evident. That's what one experiences. That's why one experiences Ananda whenever the mind becomes quiet. It becomes silent, and then one experiences a profound silence, which is what we call Ananda. Because the obstacle in the form of the projecting mind is not there at that time. Again, when the mind starts projecting, that Ananda or that the profound happiness of the Self seems to be again veiled. And thus, the verse 75 now explains how every element and every name and form actually, in there is an inherence of this asti, bhati and the priya. That's what he said. Akashe pyeva manandah, akashe pyeva manandah, satta bhane tu sammate, satta bhane tu sammate, vaivadi deha paryantam, vaivadi deha paryantam, vastushvevam vibhavyatam, vastushvevam vibhavyatam. Akashe api evam anandaha. So drishtanda is nijananda. How atma is of the nature of ananda. Similarly we say that akasha also is of the nature of ananda. We say that atma is of the nature of ananda. Not dukkha. Why? Because sukha and dukkha both are the states of mind. And vyatyaha. Another way of looking at it is, when the mind completely gets resolved, when there is no sukha and dukkha, both of them are completely resolved, at that time, what obtains is the Self, and that is the nature of ananda. So just as the atma is the nature of ananda, similarly also, akasha also is of the nature of ananda. Akasha evam anandaha. Evam in this manner, meaning just as we just showed how in the nijatma or in the Self, which is devoid of harsha and shoka, Self of the Atma, there is devoid of harsha and shoka, elation and depression. Because elation and depression both are the states of the mind on account of something desirable or undesirable. But the Self, which is always abiding, is of the nature of ananda. Similarly also, akashe evam anandaha. We therefore say that in akasha, the space also, there is also ananda is there. Satta bhane tu sammate. See, you don't have any difficulty in accepting that the space is. No problem. The space shines. No problem. The problem is, how do you say that space is of the nature of ananda? How can you say vayu is of the nature of ananda? Or fire is of the nature of ananda? This name and form is ananda. How can you say that? You have no difficulty in saying that the crystal is. Asti. Crystal shines. Bhati. So asti and bhati, both of these are quite evident in the crystal, and everybody accepts that. The problem is, how can you say that this crystal is of the nature of ananda? So first of all we say that atma is of the nature of ananda. in spite of Harsha and the Shoka being there, because they are the states of mind. And when Harsha and the Shoka, both of them are resolved, then what obtains is nothing but the Ananda, that is the Self. And similarly also we say that this Vayu is of the nature of Ananda. Vayu also is Satta, is there? Satta bhanetu sammate. Satta bhanetu bhavata api abhivagamyate. Atahana upapadaniya ityartha. Even you also accept that a name and form is and it shines. So astyan bhati, sattayan bhanam, existence and intelligence, you accept that as obtaining in akasha. But as we said so far, that akasha also is of the nature of ananda. Because with reference to akasha also, suppose the point is this, that akasha by itself is not in any way oppose the ananda. See, if akasha itself were of the nature of sadness or something, then the very perception of akasha should bring sadness into me. If anything were of the nature of shoka or dukkha or sorrow or sadness, then perception of that thing should bring sadness into me. We say no, even akasha also reflects ananda alone, because when there is no reaction or projection with reference to akasha, then I experience that ananda, even in presence of akasha. So a given perception also does not in any way deny the ananda. We are not saying that ananda is in absence of the world. Even the perception of the world does not deny the ananda if the mind is not projecting or mind is not reacting. And therefore, we say that ananda obtains in everything. Sasti, bhati, priyam. Because everything has agreeability. Everything has attractiveness. Everything is something, an attraction. Everything therefore can become an object, is an object of love. And that shows that everything has the inherent content of ananda.
Akashe pratipadita arthaha vayavadi shairanteshu bhivagantavyehiti.
And thus, what is true of akasha, the space, also is true of rest of the creation. Namely, vayu, agni, apaha, prasavi, oshadeha, and then deha. So from the akasha, the space came out there, from there the water, fire, from there the water, from there the earth, from there the plants and vegetables, and from there the body. And so in all these modifications of akasha also, the same asti bhadi priya in here. Except what happens is, when akasha gets modified as vayu, then vayu carries the qualities of the akasha, which is shabda, and carries its own quality, which is sparsha. Plus, carry the quality of the original cause, asti bhati priyam. So, original cause is Brahma, of the nature of asti bhati priyam. And therefore, space, which is the first modification, there, these characteristics of Brahma, asti bhati priyam, are there, and also the akasha has its own peculiar quality of accommodation. Then, when akasha again gives rise to what we call vayu, or the air, then the air also in the air also, inherently, asti, bhati, priyam are there. Akasha has the quality of sound, that also is there in the air, plus air has its own peculiar quality of touch and of motion and things like that. So as I said, every effect has its own peculiarity, plus it inheres the qualities of the cause also. So there is a sadharana dharma and asadharana dharma. This is what we have to understand. This is a matter of discrimination. What is sadharana dharma? Sadharana means common or universal. That every name and form that is there has a universal characteristic and a peculiar characteristic also. The universal characteristic inheres in every name and form. As Lord Krishna says, mai saram idam prodam sutre maniganaiva. Just as a thread permeates every pearl in a necklace, and so also asti, bhati and priyam, that informs every name and form. So every name and form or every object has its unique quality, which distinguishes that object from every other object. But then there is sadharana dharma, asti, bhati and priyam. It is sadharana dharma. So thus we should learn to recognize about everything asadharana dharma and sadharana dharma, the universal quality or characteristic and the peculiar characteristic. So in the next two verses, the author just gives what are the asadharana dharma or the unique characteristic of some of the things. says verse 76. Gatisparshau vayurupam, gatisparshau vayurupam, vanner daha prakashane, vanner daha prakashane, jalasya dravata bhumehe, jalasya dravata bhumehe, kathinyam cheti nirnayaha, kathinyam cheti nirnayaha, asadharana akaraha, असाधारण आकार है औषध्यं नवपुष्यवि औषध्यं नवपुष्यवि एवं विभाव्यं मनसा एवं विभाव्यं मनसा तत्तद्रूपं यथोचितं तत्तद्रूपं यथोचितं गतिस्पर्शौ वायुरूपं वायु मीन्स एयर व्हाट आर द यूनिक कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स और पेक्यूलियर कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ एयर Gatisparshav, the Vayu has Gati, movement, and Sparsha, the quality of touch. So Vayu is characterized by the peculiar qualities of motion and touch, plus the universal characteristics of Asti, Bhati and Priyam. Vanner Daha Prakashane, what is it that we call fire, which has the peculiar characteristic of Daha and Prakashanam, of burning and illumining. So fire burns and fire illumines. So burning and illumining are the unique characteristics of fire. Plus Asti, Bhati and Priyam are the Sadharana Dharma or the universal characteristics. Jalasya Dravata. What is the unique characteristic of water? Dravata, fluidity. So fluidity is the unique characteristic of water. And what's the universal characteristic of water? Asti, Bhati and Priyam. Water is, water shines, water is agreeable. Fire is, fire shines, fire is agreeable. Space is, space shines, space is agreeable. If any one of these things were not there, we could not survive. We could not survive if space were not there, because then we would not find accommodation anywhere. We could not survive if air was not there, because then our life could not be sustained. We could not survive if water was not there. Then also our life would not be sustained. Fire was not there. These elements were not there. We would not be there. So each one of these elements is desirable, agreeable, and therefore the object of love. And therefore each of them is of the nature of happiness. Bhumehe kathinyam cha iti nirnayaha. What is the unique characteristic of Prithvi or the earth? Kathinyam, hardness. So hardness or solidity. So that is the peculiar quality of the element earth. Iti nirnayaha, this is how we can ascertain their unique characteristics. Then asadharana akaraha oshadhi anna vapushyavi evam vibhavyam manasa tattadrupam yathochitam. Similarly also oshadhi in what we call the plants and vegetables, anna in the food, vapushi in the body. So from the earth come the oshadhi. From Oshadhi comes the Ahara, or Annam. From the Anna comes the Vapuhu, the body. In all of them, Asadharana, Akaraha, Evam Manasa Vibhavyam. Each one of them also has its own peculiar qualities. And Yathochitam Taddadrupam Evam Manasa Vibhavyam. In this manner, we should be able to identify the unique characteristic of everything. And understand that whether unique or Asadharana, the peculiar qualities are there, the universal qualities also are there, Asti, Bhati, Priyam. And therefore, what is the conclusion of this discussion, or what is it that ultimately we arrive at from this discussion? Verse 78 says that, Anekadha vibhinneshu, Anekadha vibhinneshu, Nama rupeshu chaikadha, Nama rupeshu chaikadha, Tishthanti Satchidananda, Tishthanti Satchidananda, Visam Vado na Kasyajida, Visam Vado na Kasyajida. Anekadha Vibhinneshu Namarupeshu. Thus, Namarupeshu, in the various names and forms, there is table, chair, crystal, flower, book, man, woman, elephant, tiger, mouse, mosquito, whatever. So, vivinneshu namarupeshu, in all these variety of and diverse names and forms, anekadha vivinneshu, all these various names and forms, all of which are thus different from each one another, all the names and forms which are different from one another, that are divided or separated from one another, as far as the unique or peculiar characteristics are concerned. Ekadha tishthanti, in spite of all these variety of names and forms, Satchidanandaha ekadha tishthanti. But every name and form invariably carries Satchit Ananda, Asti, Bhati and Priyam. Ekadha tishthanti. They are uniformly obtaining, they uniformly obtain in every name and form. Thus, chair has a chairness which distinguishes it from the table, and table has a tableness which distinguishes it from a tree or whatever, or from a crystal. However, all of them are one or uniform with reference to their universal characteristics, namely, each one is, each one shines, and each one is agreeable. So, asti, bhati, and priyam, that is, the unique, the characteristics, the universal characteristic of every name and form. Tarhi pratiyamanayoho namarupayoho kagatihi. If you say that asti bhati priya asachidananda is that which inheres in every name and form, then what is the nature of this nama and the rupa? Or what's the nature of the name and form? Iti asankhya kalpitattvam eva gatihi tyaha. Then we have to say that kalpitattvam, that every name and form is projected. And asti bhati priyam is a reality. Just as in a pot, the clay is a reality, and what we call the form and name are projected upon the clay, and so also in every name and form, to be and to shine or to reveal and to be agreeable, that is the inherent nature of every name and form, whereas all the peculiarities are superimposed upon the universal. This idea, this one universal reality upon which the peculiarities are superimposed. And depending, because of the variety of superimpositions, we have variety of names and forms. What obtains in and through every name and form is only one principle, that is Satchit Ananda. Existence, intelligence, happiness. Or existence, intelligence, love. Or existence, intelligence, order, harmony, love, happiness. That is the inherent nature of every name and form. And that is what I said in the verse 79.
Nistatve nama rupe dve, nistatve nama rupe dve, janmana shayute chate, janmana shayute chate, buddhya brahmani vikshasva, buddhya brahmani vikshasva, samudre buddhuda divate, samudre buddhuda divate. This tattve nam rupe dve. Understand that these two things, name and form, are nistatve. There is no tattva, they are unreal, meaning they are contentless, essenceless. So form and a name or the peculiarity doesn't matter at all. So to Vedanta, the peculiarity doesn't matter. As a man, what does it matter? Woman, doesn't matter. Black, so forth. White, so what? Clay, okay. Tree, all right. What matters is asti, bhati and priyam. Because name and form, what is the content or what is the reality or what is the tangibility of the name and form? Because we find that every name and form surrenders itself under the name and form. For example, this cloth is a name and form. When I analyze the reality of a cloth, it turns out of nothing but the yarn. And so the name and form cloth has actually surrendered itself to the name and form called yarn. And what is this yarn? Is nothing but the cotton. And what is cotton? Nothing but the fiber. And thus when we keep on dissolving the name and form, we find that name and form really is a standpoint. Swami calls it the adjective. So cloth is the adjective of yarn. And yarn is the adjective of cotton. Just as pot is the adjective of clay. So rather than calling it clay pot, we should rather call it potty clay. In which case, pot becomes adjective and clay becomes substantive. So adjective is something that is superimposed upon the substantive. Substantive is substance. Then what we call clay is also turns out to be an adjective of something more fundamental, namely the molecules, which turn out to be adjective of something more fundamental, atoms, which turn out to be adjective of something more fundamental, subatomic particles. And thus when we keep on reducing what is peculiar into what is general, it all resolves into pure existence or pure awareness. And therefore, every name and form turns out to be a superimposition. This tattve, nama rupe dve, this is all that we need to do. There is no other Vedanta to be learned. This is all that is to be learned. Or this much is enough, that the peculiarity does not count. What does it matter? It doesn't matter. As far as the reality or truth is concerned, the peculiarity does not count because it is nistattva, it is projected. Janmanashayute, why do you say that? Te janmanashayute, because they are endowed with what we call the birth and death. It's there now, not there later. And therefore, how long will the cloth be? It will one day get resolved into what we call the strands, and yarn, and the yarn again will one day resolve into cotton, and thus they will keep on resolving into where the further resolution cannot take place. That irreducible reality is ultimate reality, and that is what we call Sat, which is not an adjective of any other substantive. So if itself is an adjective, or itself is an effect of some other cause, then ultimately the whole inquiry or the whole process of resolving must end into that which itself is not an effect, which itself is not an adjective, and that is what we call Sat or existence. Buddhya brahmani vikshasva. And therefore, may you see in your mind, buddhya, in the buddhya or the intellect. So this knowledge of unreality is not a perceptual knowledge. That's why there is so much said about experience. In as much as experience is something that is perceptual, or experience something that is sensation. But to see the unreality of this cloth is not a sensation. Oh, I experience the unreality in the cloth. You can't experience it. Oh, I see it. You can't see it with your eyes also. That the cloth is mithya and that the yarn is true or real is not something that you can either experience in terms of a sensation, nor can you perceive it nor can you know it in terms of a perception. It is something that you see in your mind's eye, isn't it? That what we call the cloth is unreal. Can you experience that unreality? Or can you perceive that unreality? No. It is something to be known or understood in the mind. That's why to understand the mithyatvam is an understanding of the knowledge, and not therefore a sensation, nor it is a perception. Buddhya brahmani vikshasva. Therefore, may you vikshasva. So may you appreciate this fact, or see in your own mind, buddhya. By viveka buddhya. By this discriminative intellect. May you see that the names and forms do not have any tattva or any essence of their own, that both of them are projected upon Brahma. How the example is given, samudre budbudadivata. Samudre upon the ocean, or let's say upon the water. Budbudadivata. Just as upon the water, we superimpose a budbuda. Budbuda is what? A bubble. Just as we superimpose a bubble, or a wave, or a foam. So what we call wave is a projection upon the water. What we call bubble also is a projection upon the water. What we call foam also is a projection upon the water. And that is to be understood in our own mind. So just as you understand that what we call the wave is nothing but the water, name and form doesn't have any essence at all, because they remove the substance called water and there doesn't remain anything whatever which you can call name and form. If name and form had some essence, then in spite of removing water, some residue would have remained, you see. No residue remains at all. That shows that the name and form is no essence at all. And the only essence is water there. And thus everywhere, only essence is Asti, Bhati and Priyam, which is Brahma. So says here the teacher, may you see this in your own mind. Tata Kim. Suppose I see that, then what? What is to accomplish? Suppose I see this fact in my mind, that every name and form is mithya, and every name and form is nothing but a vehicle to reveal Asti, Bhati and the Priyam. You can say that name and form is a costume, which is worn by Brahma Asti Bhadi Priyam. Inasmuch as Brahman or Asti Bhadi Priyam cannot be perceived directly, it has in all its kindness become perceptible to us. See how kind that God or Asti Bhadi Brahma is, that had it remained Brahman, nobody would ever see it or know it, and therefore it has become manifest in the form, in name and form. But then why did it manifest in all the variety? That's nice. Otherwise you'll get so for your own enjoyment that you can enjoy things. In a variety of name and form, Brahman has become manifest. The very same thing confuses us, unfortunately. Because to us, name and form is so important that we forget that name and form are merely occasions or merely instrumental for the manifestation of the Asti Bhati Priya. So name and form is like a costume, and the real essence is Asti Bhati Priyam. Tatah Kim, suppose you see that, then what will happen? Says verse 18.
Satchidananda rupesmin, Satchidananda rupesmin, Purne brahmani vikshite, Purne brahmani vikshite, Swayame vava janati, Swayame vava janati, Nama rupeshanaishanehi, Nama rupeshanaishanehi. Satchidananda rupe asmin purne brahmani vikshite swayameva avajanati nama rupe shanaihi shanaihi. Asmin purne satchidananda rupe brahmani vikshite. All of this is sati saptami. So when this Brahmani Vikshite, when Brahman is Vikshite, meaning when Brahman is seen, or perceived, or is known, is what? Purne, that which is complete, which is non-dual, that which does not exclude anything, or that which is all-inclusive. So that which is all-pervasive is complete. And what is all-pervasive? That beyond which there is nothing. There is no name and form, there is nothing that ever exists in this creation that could ever be apart from Asti, Bhati and Priyam. Is it possible for the wave to somehow create a distance with water? Is it possible for an ornament to run away from the gold? Is it possible for the pot to divorce the clay? Not possible. Because wherever the pot is, the clay must be. And pot is the superimposition on the clay. And therefore, clay is what? Purna or complete, because it includes every pot, is all-inclusive. So as we say that, the Asti Bhati Priyam is Purnam, is complete. Meaning it fills up everything. It is the very content of everything. So that is really substance everywhere. What enables this crystal to exist, and what enables it to shine, what enables it to be agreeable, is nothing but Asti. And that is why that is Purnam, is complete. It does not lack anything, because it does not exclude anything. If something is excluded from me, then I can feel a sense of lack, or a sense of deprivation. But then, when nothing is excluded, everything is mine. So whole universe is mine. Everything is mine. And even better than that, everything is I. Then there is nothing that is excluded, nothing lacking. So Brahman is that which is totally devoid of any sense of lack or incompleteness. Vikshite Satchidananda Rupe, that which is Satchit and Ananda. So Brahman, which is Satchit Ananda, which is complete, non-dual, all-inclusive, all-pervasive. Vikshite, when it is seen. Swayameva Avajanati Nama Rupe Shanehi Shanehi. Then slowly and slowly, this seer, or this wise man, this knower, himself, shanehi shanehi, slowly and slowly, nama rupe avajanati. He slowly and slowly becomes what? Indifferent to the name and form. Avajanati means, in fact, he starts negating, insulting, or giving less and less importance to name and form. So more and more the person becomes aware of the content, namely Asti Bhati Priyam, less and less concerned he remains of the form in which Asti Bhati Priyam manifests,
or the form in the name. Just as more and more concerned one becomes with gold, less and less concerned one becomes within the form in which the gold comes, or the ornament in which the gold comes, because what is important is gold, the substance. As long as this was not known, so long perhaps the design of an ornament and its name and everything else was important. But now that what has become important is the very substance that is an ornament, which is the gold. And then, more and more I become aware of the gold which is essence. And more I see that ornament is nothing but the gold, less and less concerned I become of the form in which that gold comes. Similarly also, more and more concerned, awareful, I become avasti, bhati and priyam of such chit, ananda, which is what we call purusha, the person. And what is name and form? The personality is the name and form. So more and more tuned up I become to the person, less and less concerned I become of the personality. This idea that more and more tuned up, focus my attention becomes to the water. Let's say I'm standing there on the ocean front, on the seashore, and I'm watching these waves. As long as my mind is preoccupied with every peculiarity of the waves, so long I also as though remain unaware of the content which is water. But as more and more my mind gets focused upon the essence which is water, less and less awareful I become of even the wave, and less concerned I become of the name and form. And similarly also in this world, more and more awareful and more centered we become on the essence which is asti, bhati, priyam. So what matters is that I am. Doesn't matter where I am or how I am, that's fine. That I am intelligent, I am aware. Doesn't matter what I am aware of, but that I am aware. And that I am the unconditional object of my love. And thus, that fact about me should be enough to make me happy. Suppose even this simple fact about me, that how wonderful that I am. How wonderful that I am aware. Suppose that itself could be enough for me to become happy. Is it ever possible that I can become unhappy? See, if my happiness is derived simply from the fact that I exist, or that I am aware, if that itself could be where the source of my happiness, is it ever possible that the happiness can be denied? It can never be denied, because regardless of where I am and how I am that fact nobody can take away from me. That I am big, that can be dismissed when some bigger thing comes. That I am wonderful, may not be. That I am smart, may not be. That I am strong, may not be. All of these things can come and go. But that I am. Happy, unhappy, big, small, tall, short, smart, stupid, whatever it is, I am. I'm aware of bigness, aware of smallness, aware of smartness, but aware. What I'm aware of can change, but that I'm aware cannot change. What I am can change, but that I am cannot change. And so that is what the scriptures tell us. That appreciate the fact that you are, that's enough for you. You don't need anything else. And as indifferent you keep on becoming about what you are and how you are and where you are, and remain deferent to the fact that you are. And not only about myself, about anything. What counts about anything is that it is. That it shines. Doesn't matter whether it is yellow or red or white or blue or black. It is tall or short. It doesn't matter. That it is what matters. That it shines is what matters. And when that alone matters, I'll find everything agreeable. See, as long as I am concerned about name and form, then alone the question of agreeability and disagreeability comes. But when what is important to me is that something is and it shines, then I find that every name and form also is agreeable, because it doesn't matter to me what it is. I find everything being agreeable, because ultimately it is asti and bhati. That existence and awareness is agreeable always. Svayameva avajanati. To the extent that this wise man becomes more and more keenly centered or focused upon the essence of the asti, bhati and priya, he himself becomes less and less, more and more indifferent to the name and form. Not indifferent doesn't mean that he starts hating them, disliking them or what. He becomes more and more accepting of name and form, meaning the peculiarities of name and form become less and less important to him. Because what counts for him, to him, is that every name and form manifests or reveals Asti, Bhati and Priyam. And that being the case, Brahmajnana Dardhyasya, and therefore, in order to gain the Dardhyam, in order to gain that firmness in Brahmajnanam, firmness in knowledge of Brahma, Dvaita Avajna Purvakatvat, inasmuch as firmness in the knowledge of Brahma has to be accompanied with or has to be preceded by an indifference towards the name and form. Shravanadivat Dvaita Avajnapi Kartavya. And therefore, here the teacher also adds one more means to the firmness of knowledge. Just as we require Shravanam, the listening to the scriptures, Mananam, reflection upon what we have listened to, Nidhyasanam, an alert abidance or assimilation of what we have learned. Similarly also, Dvaita Avajnapi Kartavya. It is necessary that we should become more and more indifferent to the dvaita or the duality. More and more indifferent to the peculiarities and more deferent to the universalities. Shift our focus from the peculiarity to the universality. This is what is meant by vairagya. Raga and the dvesha or attachments and aversions are going to be there as long as my attention is focused upon the peculiarity. Because when I consider myself as a peculiar person, possessed of or of the nature of name and form, then I look upon another name and form as either agreeable or disagreeable, because the personality can never be agreeable to every personality. The person is going to be agreeable to every personality. Or person will be agreeable to every person and every personality, but a personality cannot be agreeable to every personality. Personality is his own peculiarity. And that peculiarity being there is going to be agreeability and disagreeability whenever something is viewed from the standpoint of name and form. So as that viewpoint is changed, instead of viewing something from name and form, when I start viewing it as what it is, then Asti Bhati Priyam. That is called Dvaita Avajna, an indifference to the Dvaita or the duality, an indifference to the name and form, an indifference to the peculiarity, inasmuch as peculiarity is a projection upon the universality, or the duality is a projection upon non-duality. The non-dual is the truth, and the dual is mithya or is false, and therefore one should constantly attempt to shift the focus from the dual to the non-dual, from the unreal to the real. And that is said in the verse 81.
Yavadyavadavajnasyad tavattavattadikshanam tavattavattadikshanam yavadyavadvikshyate tate tavattavadubhetyajed.
Yavadyavadavajnasyad. So this should be our approach. So what should be the approach of a student of Vedanta? One who is seeking the knowledge of Brahma and one who is seeking an abidance in the knowledge. What should approach in life? What should approach in our day-to-day conduct also?
Yavad yavad avajnasyat.
To the extent that this duality, I become more and more indifferent to the duality.
Tavat tavat tadikshanam.
To that extent, tadikshanam, there is an appreciation of Brahma, the non-dual. So again, that indifference to the duality also is in the mind, not perceptually. It is not even necessary that I have to close my eyes to the duality, or I have to have an aversion for the duality. I just have to note in my mind constantly the fact that the duality is unreal, and to the extent that I see the unreality of duality, to that extent, I appreciate the reality of the non-dual.
Tavat tavat tadikshanam, then there is dikshanam or knowledge or appreciation of tat, meaning that Brahma.
Yavad yavad vikshate tada. And as one progressively appreciates that Brahman, tavat tavat ubhetyajet, to that extent the name and form are given up. To the extent that the unreality of the duality is seen, to that extent one appreciates the reality of Brahman. And to the extent that one appreciates Brahman, the reality of it, to that extent the peculiarity of name and form is given up. So how the name and form, the importance given to the peculiarity of the name and form, how they slowly start dropping off, to the extent that I become more and more keenly aware of Asti, Bhati and Priyam. But how can I become more keenly aware of Asti, Bhati, Priyam? To the extent that I see the mithyatvam of the duality. To the extent that one sees the mithyatvam of the duality, to that extent one becomes focused upon the reality of non-dual. To the extent that one becomes focused upon reality of non-dual, to that extent the name and form, they become less and less important. And this is how, says here the author, that this also is very important. And that is how you will find that the values that we discuss, like the 20 values, each value is nothing but shifting the focus of attention from the unreal to the real. About myself and about others also. When we say the values amanitvam, adambhitvam, ahimsa, kshantihi, arjavam, I say that absence of pride is my value. Why is it so? Pride belongs to name and form. And the self is devoid of pride. Adambhitvam, freedom from pretentiousness is my value. Why? Pretense can be there only in the name and form of the personality. The person or self is non-pretentious. Ever the same. Ever shines, doesn't have to hide. Ahimsa, non-violence. Because violence can be there only in the mithya, which is product of ignorance. And our self is non-violent. Kshantihi, accommodation, coming to other people. That I accommodate, I respect everything, because everything inherently is Asti Bhati Priyam. And therefore, the name and form should not be important. Asti Bhati Priyam is important. Thus, ultimately, when we see, even when we practice those values, automatically this happens. Though practicing the values every time will require shifting of the attention, focus. Otherwise, it's not possible to practice the value. When I shift the focus upon my true self, then amanitvam, adambhitvam are possible. Or when I focus the attention of the true self with the other one, then alone ahimsa, kshanti will be possible. Not otherwise. The other things that all I do, bhavana, you know, have fake and make and stuff like that is okay. Ultimately, however, one has to say that all the, what we call manitvam, dambhitvam, the pride, the pretentiousness, the violence, all of these only arise from ignorance because of giving reality to the peculiarity, to the duality, to the name and form. And if I continue to give reality to them, there's no way that you can practice a value or no way that you can ever have the perception of non-dual. So we have to drop off things, we have to give up things. More you hold on to, more we're holding on to the unreal or the projection. And less you hold on to, and more we become identified with the adhisthanam, the substratum. So that's why the author says that like shravanam mananam, this also should be done. Okay. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Vadarayanam Sutra Bhashya Krutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah. Ishvaro Guru Ratmedi Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyoma Vadvyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namaha. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.